One thing we have understood by now is that no material is perfectly rigid. Under the action of forces, it has to undergo some changes in its shape and size. Now, this phenomenon of changing its shape and size might be visible to us in case of rubber, but what about in case of metals? Although it is not visible to us to our naked eyes, but there has to be some changes in shape and size for the applied force, even in case of metals like steel, cast iron, brass, and so on. Even say a concrete columns, concrete structures, and so on. You take any material, it has to undergo some changes in its shape and size when it is subjected to external loads. So in this case, similarly, here we have one material, and then let us subject it to some force, say P, in its axial direction. So what we have done is, to this material we have applied some forces P in its axial direction, in the direction of its axis. And then if I draw its direction of its axis, it will be somewhat like this, right? This will be the axis of this material, and the forces are applied in the direction of its axis. Now under this applied force, we know that since this material is not rigid, it will undergo some deformation. And then since the forces are applied in the longitudinal direction or in the direction of axis, the elongation will be in the direction of this axis. And then suppose the original length was L, and the change in length which is observed from this point to this point after this application of this load P, let us call it as DL, then the way we can define this strain is, this will be called as linear strain. I can define this linear strain as change in length divided by original length, right? Change in length divided by original length. And I can use a Greek symbol epsilon to denote this linear strain. So linear strain will be, in this case, what is change in length? DL is, this small length DL is the change in length, right? So it will be DL divided by L. So in this case, this is the original length and this is the extension or change in length. Now this is what we have observed in its longitudinal direction or axial direction. But what about the changes in its transverse direction? For example, now if this is the bar which was subjected to this load P, this is the cross section of this bar, then in case of the application of this force P, what will happen is, we have seen that in its axial direction there will be elongation, right? There will be elongation in axial direction. This up to here, it was the original length, and then we have here DL in this direction. But then one thing we need to observe is that even in its transverse direction or in the other or in the direction perpendicular to the axis, there will be again some changes, and that can be observed here. The original dimensions of this cross section of this bar, let us say if it was B, then after the application of force, after the change in length in the longitudinal direction, it will undergo also the change in the dimensions in lateral dimension, in its lateral direction, and let us call that as B dash. So how to define now this lateral strain? Again, it will be same thing. Lateral strain will be nothing but it is change in length or change in dimension divided by original dimension. Now how much is the change in dimension here, or change in length in lateral direction? Originally it was B, right? Minus the, it has gone to B dash. So B minus B dash is the change in the length. And if we divide this by the original length B, we will get this as a lateral strain. And even this lateral strain, we can define it as epsilon. And I can denote this B minus B dash as small change in B, that is dB, divided by B. So this will be the definition of the linear strain. Also, this strain can be called as longitudinal strain. right? Longitudinal strain or linear strain. Okay, now this changes we witnessed this changes when it was subjected to the tensile forces, or the forces were going away from this bar. Now what if I am subjecting, if I subject this material to the compressive force P? What if I subject this material to compressive force P? In this case, what will happen is it will undergo compression, and then the final length of the material will become less than the original length. Suppose say in this case original length was L from here to here, then the change in length will be BL from here to here. This will be the change in length. And even in this case, again I can define strain as change in length divided by original length. All right. So this is how we can define strain. Strain is nothing but change in length divided by original length. And then this can be called as the linear strain, and this can be called as the lateral strain. Even that is also, we can denote it by epsilon. So under strains, we saw two kind of strains at present. One is the longitudinal strain, which acts in the axial direction or in the longitudinal direction of the bar. And the second kind of strain we saw is something which we observe in its cross section, and we can call that kind of strain as lateral strain. So both these strains fall under normal strains. All right, fall under this category of normal strain. So what is normal strain? What all comes under normal strain? There will be linear strain or longitudinal strain, and then there will be lateral strain, and then there will be lateral strain. Now what if a material is subjected to shear load? What if the material is subjected to this kind of shear load? Now in this case, this bar will not extend. There won't be any extensions which will be visible in this case, or neither there will be any kind of compression visible in this case, but the material will deform in this fashion. It will deform like this. The original angle which was 90, here, it will change to some other angle, right? So this is the deformation which can be seen when it is subjected to a shear load. Now in this case, I cannot define the strains here in terms of normal strain, but I will have to define here the strain in terms of shear strain. And the shear strain is denoted by gamma, Greek letter gamma. And at this stage, I will not define the expression for this shear strain. But what you need to understand at this stage is there can be two kind of strains which can get developed in a material. First one we call it as normal strain. Under normal strain, we can have two types of strain, linear strain as well as lateral strain. Then the second kind of major strain which can be observed is called as shear strain. This is just like the two kind of stresses which we had observed, normal stress and shear stress. Similarly, we will have here normal strain and shear strain. Now let us discuss about the units of strain. Now what do you think? What will be the units of the strain? See here, this is the change in length, right? It may be in terms of mm or meter or centimeter, whatever. Similarly, even the length will be in terms of meter or centimeter or mm, whatever. So basically, there will be no units for strain. So strain is a dimensionless quantity. There won't be any units as such for strain. So strain is an unitless quantity. So this is what all we can discuss about the strains at this stage. So just to summarize, we saw there can be something called as normal stresses and strains, and there can be something called as shear stresses and strain, right? Shear stresses and strain. The normal stress can be denoted as sigma, whereas the shear stresses can be denoted as tau. Similarly, the normal strains can be denoted as epsilon, whereas the shear strains can be denoted by gamma. Now Next, what we will do is we will try to see if there exists any relation between stresses and strains. All right, we will try to establish, we'll try to see if there is some relation between these quantities, normal stresses and normal strains, or if there is some relation between shear stresses and shear strain. So this will be our topic of discussion now. All right, so for this what we will do is we will try to understand how we can obtain the relation between stress and strain by using experimental method. And to do that we will have to perform this experiment on a machine called as universal testing machine, also called as UTM. All right, what is done in this experiment is the specimens, standard specimens are prepared under proper guidelines, and then you can see a typical diagram of a specimen here. Something called as gauge length is marked on this specimen, and then there are grips here which will be used in this case. This chucks, this upper chuck and lower chuck, it will hold on this specimen with the help of this grips. It will hold on this grips here, and then some forces will be applied, some calculated measured forces will be applied. Then one end of this chuck will try to pull this specimen in the upward direction. And that is how, after certain amount of force and after certain time, it will start getting deformed. It will start getting deformed here, and something called as neck formation will take place. Something called as neck formation will take place after certain amount of load is applied, and then finally the failure will occur at some point, and then there will be and then the failure in typical ductile material can be observed in this fashion. It will be in the form of cup and cone. It will be in the form of cup and cone. So the failure at the neck will be in the form of cup and cone, and this is, I think, the actual specimen which was tested on the UTM machine. All right, so this is how the experiment can be performed. Now let us straight away discuss the results of any ductile material for this stress strain test. All right, so for this what we will do is we will take the example of MS or mild steel. If we had done the similar test on mild steel specimen, here the material is mild steel, then if I draw the stress strain diagram, if I draw the stress strain diagram for this mild steel specimen when it is tested on this UTM, I will get a curve which will look somewhat like this. Initially it will have some linear behavior. Let me draw a proper line. We'll have some linear behavior, and then we'll see one point here, and then again it will come down, and then again it will go on top, and finally it will fail. All right, at this point, at around this point, it will fail. So basically we can observe here some critical points. And then now in this topic, what we will do is we will discuss those critical points. I can identify some critical points here at this place. I can identify one point at this place, and then I can identify one critical point here at the peak of this curve. I can identify one more critical point here, and then one point here at this stage, and then finally the point of failure. So this curve will be valid only for ductile materials like mild steel. All right, and this curve will be observed only for this kind of specimen, ductile specimen like mild steel. Now let us discuss these points one by one. I will call this point as point A, point B, point C, point D, and point E. Now let us first discuss point A. What is point A? This point A is called as limit of proportionality. Now what does this mean is, up to this point the stress will be directly proportional to strain. और लीनियरली प्रोपोर्शनल टू स्ट्रेन. सो अप टू दिस पॉइंट, अप टू पॉइंट ए, अप टू पॉइंट ए स्ट्रेस, व्हाट विल ऑब्जर्व इज स्ट्रेस इज डायरेक्टली और लीनियरली प्रोपोर्शनल टू स्ट्रेन, राइट? स्ट्रेस विल बी लीनियरली प्रोपोर्शनल टू स्ट्रेन. देन बिफोर गोइंग टू पॉइंट बी, वी नीड टू डिस्कस वन मोर इम्पोर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट हियर, एंड दैट इज इलास्टिक लिमिट. इलास्टिक लिमिट. Now, the elastic limit of a material is nothing but it is a limit wherein up to which if I can release the load, it will come back to its original shape or it will be able to regain its shape and size, and that is what is called as elastic limit. For example, rubber. If you load a rubber material, if you try to pull it, and then if you release the load, it will regain its shape and size. The same thing can be observed in metal also. But of course, the elastic limit of metal will be very less compared to rubber, but it will have certain elastic limit, and this limit will be slightly beyond this point A. But for a practical purpose, what we consider is we usually say that these points overlap, all right? But it will be slightly ahead of this proportionality limit. So elastic limit is the limiting value. Elastic limit is the limiting value of stress up to which if the material is stressed and then released, strains will disappear. The strains will disappear completely. That means no mark of any deformation will remain if we release the load within this elastic limit of any material. It will regain back its shape and size. So this is the second point which we need to understand. Then the third point will be point C, right? First point A was the limit of proportionality. Then there will be one more point slightly beyond this point A, which is called as elastic limit. Then point B. We are coming now to point B. Now the point B is called as upper yield point. And if someone doesn't want a permanent deformation in material, then this point plays a very important role, because at this point it is the maximum amount of stress a material can take before undergoing the permanent deformation. Even after the yield point, it will take some amount of load. I mean, even after the elastic limit, it will take some amount of load before it undergoes the permanent deformation. So if someone doesn't want a permanent deformation on its material, then he shouldn't load the material beyond this yield point. So what will happen is, beyond this point, the load starts reducing. Beyond this point, the load starts reducing, and the extension increases. Basically, after this, material stops giving any resistance to the applied load, and even for a small load, it will have a good amount of deformation. So basically, it starts giving up. It yields at this point. And then after this, we get our third point, that is point C. Now point C is called as lower yield point. What happens at this point is, for some time at this stage, what will happen is, the stresses remain same. The value of stress remains same. At this stage, the value of stress, it will remain same, but strain increases for some time. You can observe it here. here you will have almost a line, a straight horizontal line kind of thing, because here what happens is the stress do not increase, but stress it will remain same, but strain increases for some time. And after this point, what will happen is the material will again start giving some resistance. It will start producing stresses for a given load. And up to which point it will produce the load? Up to our point D. Up to our point D, it will start resisting the load. Up to our point D, it will again start resisting the load. It will produce stresses in it. So this point D is called as ultimate stress. Point D is called as ultimate stress. And to be more precise, if this material was subjected to tensile loading, like in this case, if it was subjected to tensile loading, we can call this as ultimate tensile stress. Ultimate tensile stress. So what is the significance of this point, ultimate tensile stress? This is the maximum stress. This is the maximum stress. This is the maximum stress the material can resist. This is the maximum tensile stress the material can resist. All right, this is the maximum tensile stress the material can resist. And then, and from here on, it won't be able to give any resistance to the applied load. And finally, at point E, it will break. The material specimen will break, and it will take the form of cup and cone if it is a ductile material. So point E can be called as a breaking point. Point E can be called as a breaking point, wherein the stresses, the stress at which finally the specimen fails. All right, the specimen fails is called breaking point. So basically the material fails at this point. So material fails and it becomes into two pieces. It fails into two pieces like this, what is shown here. All right, so this is the typical behavior of a mild steel material, which is very much ductile. Now, if you try to plot the same plot stress strain curve for different kind of materials, for example, if you plot it for say aluminium, if you plot the same curve for say aluminium or high strength steel, then the curve which is observed will be somewhat like this. Then the curve which will be observed will be, this is again our axis for which shows what? Stress versus strain. And if you observe the stress strain curve for this material, it will be somewhat like this. So here basically we cannot clearly see where are our yield points, at which point the material will start yielding. But here in case of this material, in case of mild steel, we can see this yield point very clearly. Suppose say further, if we go for a brittle material, if we consider any brittle material, then the stress strain curve will look somewhat like this. And the stress, if this is again our axis of stress and strain, then in case of brittle material, the curve will look somewhat like this. This, the yield points are not very much clear. This brittle material will not even show the ultimate stress. It will directly fail just like that. All right. But here in case of aluminium or high strength steel, it will at least show us the ultimate strength point. And even the necking in this kind of material takes place at this point, that is ultimate strength point. All right, or ultimate stress point of the material, the necking will take place here. And here there is no necking as such. It will directly break into two pieces. It will fail directly. All right, so this is the relation between stress and strain. So for us, for this course, we will be only interested to load the material up to this point, up to the point B. We won't be loading the material beyond the yield point. So for our material, we can assume this, that in this, at least in this course, in this course of mechanics of solids, we will we'll always assume that the stresses will be proportional to strain in this elastic limit. Alright, stresses will be proportional to strain. So this will be what we'll be going ahead with, by considering that stresses will be proportional to strain, because in this course we won't be loading the material beyond the yield point of this material. Now, Robert Hooke was the scientist. Robert Hooke was the, in fact, he was the English mathematician, Robert Hooke, right? Robert Hooke was the English mathematician who conducted several experiments on different types of materials, on different types of material, and then he proposed that, and then he, after performing various experiments, he concluded that stresses will be proportional, stresses will be proportional to strain in a material within its elastic limit. So this is what Robert Hooke concluded after performing various experiments, that the stresses will be proportional to strain in a material within its elastic limit. And now you might think this is obvious, because we could see that here itself, that stresses are proportional to strain within elastic limit up to this point. Yes, now it is very obvious to us, but he was the first one to find that. All right, before he found this, it was not obvious to other people, but he was the first to find that the stresses will be proportional to strain in a material within its elastic limit. So with this, what we can say is, what he stated was, just to put it in notations, stress is proportional to strain. All right, and then this proportionality sign can be removed as follows. I can say stress is equal to E times epsilon, where what is sigma? Sigma is normal stress. What is epsilon? Epsilon is normal strain. And now the question is, what is E? So here E is Young's modulus. E is called as Young's modulus. Also sometimes E is called as modulus of elasticity, and this was named after English scientist or a British scientist with name Thomas Young. And let me tell you that since we had said that this elastic limit is very close to the limit of proportionality, Robert Hooke had concluded that stress will be proportional to strain only up to this point, limit of proportionality. But as we know, the elastic limit is also very close to the limit of proportionality. So we will say that this is valid up to the elastic limit of the material. And let me tell you that this holds good only for a ductile material, a pure ductile material as such, wherein or wherever there the stress is proportional to strain, only in those material this law, that is Hooke's law, will be valid, and it might not be valid for a pure brittle material. All right, so henceforth, what will be the relation between stress and strain now in the limit of proportionality? Stress will be proportional to strain, and I can remove this proportionality constant by saying sigma is equal to E times epsilon. Now what is this E? E is Young's modulus, and it is a fixed value for a given material. For example, for a steel specimen, this value of E will be always 210 GPa, right? So henceforth, we will say that up till the limit of proportionality, stresses will be proportional to strain, or stress is equal to E times epsilon.